Something strange is happening in the ocean off the west coast. Laura James was one of the first to notice. She alerted scientists when starfish began washing up on the shores near her Seattle home.
And I thought, you know what? This is getting a little too close for comfort. I need to go see what's going on, and I need to document it.
As a diver and underwater videographer, James was equipped to do something. She decided to take her camera to a spot popular among both divers and starfish. These pilings are usually covered with a rainbow of starfish. On a recent dive, James discovered a scene from a horror film.
There were bodies everywhere, and they were just like these splats. To me, it always looked like someone had taken a laser gun and just zapped them, and they just vaporized.
Starfish, also known as sea stars, are wasting away by the millions, not just in Washington's Puget Sound, but up and down North America's Pacific coast. And nobody knows why.
I've been diving out here for almost 24 years, and people always ask me, do you see any big difference between, you know, now and when you started? And I've seen some subtle differences, but this is the change of my lifetime. We've had small occasional die-offs here and there, but it's not like this. It's not a mass mortality event. You know, I'm just a diver. I need to find out what the scientists know.
But scientists have also been wondering what's going on. They first started noticing sick and dying starfish on Washington's Olympic Peninsula during the summer of 2013. Reports have since surfaced from all along the California coast to as far north as Alaska. And the disease affects almost every species of West Coast starfish. It's been coined sea star wasting syndrome, and it's also been reported at sites along the East Coast. But researchers say it's still too early to connect these outbreaks.
You know, I was surprised, too, that the crabs weren't just...
Ben Miner is a biology professor at Western Washington University. He studies how environmental changes affect marine life. His team is collecting sea stars at Mukilteo, Washington, just north of Seattle.
The population of sea stars is, they're quite abundant at that site. And so on the pilings, there were healthy sea stars, but we were also coming across arms and piles of deteriorated sea stars and individuals that were twisted.
The divers are searching for stars showing symptoms, as well as ones that appear healthy.
The experiments are infectiousness experiments, where we take individuals that have signs of the syndrome and we put them in tanks with individuals that don't have signs.
Then they closely watch the progress of the disease. First, the stars twist their arms into knots, and sometimes lesions form on their skin.
One of them was very sick, and the other two individuals started ripping themselves apart. The arms just crawl away from the particular body.
You heard that right. The arms start crawling in opposite directions until they tear away from the body and their insides spill out. And unlike most starfish, the arms don't regenerate. Stars that came in with symptoms died within 24 hours. Through experiments like these, scientists have determined that the disease spreads through the water and through physical contact. They're also testing the hypothesis that the pathogen may be transferred through shellfish, which starfish like to eat. But scientists still don't know what caused the outbreak in the first place. Could an infectious pathogen from the other side of the world have hitched a ride on ocean-going ships? Or could it be something larger, like climate change or ocean acidification?
So this is a healthy pycnopodia. No signs of lesions.
Drew Harvell is coordinating the research into answering those questions. She's been studying marine diseases for decades and has never seen anything like this before.
This is the largest disease outbreak that we know of ever in the oceans, in terms of the numbers of species affected, in terms of the geographic scale, and in terms of the mortality that's associated with it.
Harvell is sending these samples to the lab to be analyzed for viruses, as well as bacteria and other protozoa. Once the pathogen is identified, scientists will better understand whether West Coast starfish will be able to recover. In the meantime, Harvell is keeping a close eye on the starfish that live near Washington's San Juan Islands. Until recently, the starfish here were spared. Cold water around the island seems to have protected them. But summertime means warmer waters, and stars here are suddenly showing symptoms. Their bodies are deflated, they're unable to hold onto rocks, and their arms are falling off.
I'm expecting that in the next 2 weeks we will lose virtually all the stars at this site.
Today, Harvell is searching for baby starfish. Whether starfish survive on these beaches in years to come depends on these juveniles.
We would really love the sign of hope that maybe they'll pull through, so we're going to be watching them very closely.
If the juveniles can't withstand the disease, it could be a very long time before West Coast starfish recover. And such a loss could have far-reaching ecological consequences.
We're losing a whole guild of stars that are voracious predators, all of which can control their ecosystem. And so to lose all of them at once, we don't even know what's going to happen.
If there's a silver lining, it may be that studying this outbreak could shed light on how marine diseases spread.
One, two, three, four,
and
five,
that's a question six. Laura James is hoping citizen scientists can help answer.
The big problem we had here is that we didn't have a baseline. The starfish got sick when we noticed. Wouldn't it be cool if we could show this in real time and show the spread and the changes in real time?
James and her dive buddy built a website for tracking posts to social media sites with the hashtag #SickStarfish.
Take a picture of any starfish you find when you're out tide pooling or just walking on the beach and hashtag it #SickStarfish. And then we can look at it when it pops up on the map, or if we're not sure, we can send it off to the scientists and they can take a look at it. We may not be able to stop it, and we may not be able to fix it, but we need to be aware so that we can recognize it when it happens again.